Good morning. I am an adult Sunday school teacher, and our lesson today is entitled Babylonian Captivity Ends. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, we come this morning, first of all, to give you thanks. Lord God, we thank you for another opportunity to come out to study your word. Pray, oh God, that those who are listening will have a mind to receive and a heart open to the Lord. So we thank you and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. As I was looking at this lesson, the thing that caught my mind a lot was the fact that the Israelites had been in captivity for 70 years. 70 years is a long time. And this is not the first time and not the last time that they were in captivity. And they were in captivity for their disobedience. Now, if I was in front of my Sunday school class, I would ask them a question that I always ask them. Because I would call the Israelites repeat offenders. What is a repeat offender? A person that continues to do something over and over again. We know that they would be disobedient and God would put them in captivity. They would cry out to the Lord and he would bring them out and they would be disobedient again and he would put them in captivity and they would cry out to the Lord and he would bring back them out again. Repeat offenders. Are we repeat offenders of anything, of our disobedience or sin? Let us not be repeat offenders. Also notice that when we talk about captivity, we are now in a kind of a captivity with this pandemic. We can't do all the things that we used to do. We're confined to the house, but we're not so bad as what the Israelites, because they could do nothing. We can do some things, but we are still in a type of captivity. And but God gives us a scripture, one that he asked us to do something. And I thought I had it marked, but I think I do. I think I don't. Anyway, we know 2 Chronicles 7:14, don't we? Everybody know 2 Chronicles 7:14? Most of us can repeat it by heart, but I don't want to get any of the words confused. But I do know that it says, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and do what? Pray. Seek my face. Turn from our wicked ways. He says what? Then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin and heal their land. So we have to do something God has asked us to do. And so often we don't pray. My question is, are we praying? Are we seeking the Lord? Our scripture text, is printed text, is Ezra 1:1-8, verse 11, and Ezra 2:64-70. What kind of book is Ezra? Ezra is one of the history books. Is that right? I aim for change. By the end of the lesson, we will examine the rebuilding plan for the temple in Jerusalem that God gave to King Cyrus. Believe and trust that God provides resources for the task God asks us to do, and share situations in which believers will trust God's provision and act in faith. Our end focus after 27 years of ministry to the community, the leaders of the Samaritan Evangelistic Center knew it was time for them to move out of their old facility. The walls were crumbling, the foundation was shifting, and the stairs had begun cracking. Plus, Samaritan Evangelistic Center was ministering to more people than they could possibly hold in the old building, which made the facility fire hazard. The executive committee of the center began looking for an existing structure in the community, close to their present location. But after months of searching and talking with prospective realtors, the committee couldn't find a suitable building that would meet their needs and gave them greater opportunity to expand their ministry to domestic abuse survivors. So the committee decided to buy a parcel of land right next door to their present location and build a new facility from the ground up. Executive Director Brenda Charles said, "Given the circumstances, it was the most feasible and logical thing to do." The committee's accountant said, "Building projects are never easy to accomplish. Not only are there finances to be raised, but also material to buy, construction crews to hire, and deadlines to meet in order to finish the goal in a timely manner. Any wrinkle in the schedule can hinder the process." The committee knew the most important thing to do was to pray. Sometimes we remember to rely on God's provisions and guidance from the start. When have you forgotten to plan with God? So often we leave out God in our plans. And then when we get in trouble, we want to call upon the Lord to ask Him to help us. I keep in mind verse, "And some of the chiefs of the fathers, when they came to the house of the Lord, which is at Jerusalem, offered freely for the house of God to set up this place." Our focal verses, Ezra 1 through 8, verse 11, and then chapter 2, 64 through 70. Reads as thus: "Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also in writing, saying." Now one thing in this verse that Cyrus said, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. So often the Lord would send the prophets to give a word to various people, and they would always say, "The word of the Lord said," or "The word of the Lord came to him," letting them know that this is not my word, but this is the word that God gave me to give to you. Verse 2, "Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has charged me to build him an house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is there among you of all the people? Has God be with you? And let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, should build the house of the Lord, God of Israel. He is the God which is in Jerusalem." And I heard Reverend Smith said when she was doing her lesson that Darius was not a server of God. He didn't believe in God. Also, in this lesson, we find that Cyrus is not either. And I just want to give you a verse in Isaiah 45, verse 4. Isaiah 45, verse 4 says, "For Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel my elect, I have even called you by your name. I have named you, though you have not known me. That's what he's saying. I have called you, but you have not known me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God beside me. I will gird you through, though you have not known me. Now, so often we as believers say a lot of times, well, God can't use them because they don't know the Lord. They don't know his word. They don't serve them. But I bring to you today that God can use whoever he wants, whenever he wants. He don't have to ask none of us. God is sovereign, and he does what he wants. You know, God even used a donkey one time, right? So we know that God can use whoever he wants to accomplish his purpose, and he will use whoever he wants to get his message across and to get things that he needs to have done. Verse 4, and whosoever remaineth in my place where he sojourneth, let the men of this place help him with silver and with gold and with goods and with beasts, besides the freewill offering for the house of God that is in Jerusalem. Then rose up the chief of the fathers of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and the Levites with them, whose spirit God had raised to go to build the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. And all they that were about them, let me go back to this for just a minute, where we were talking about God can use anybody that they want to. I asked a question, if you were building a building, or if we were building a new church, would we ask the people, are they saved? No, we would just use them to get done what we wanted to get done. So we do know that anybody can be used. And there's some beautiful sanctuaries that have been built. And half of the contractors who would build them didn't know anything about the Lord. So be careful seeing who God can use. Then rose up the chief of the fathers of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and the Levites with all of them whose spirit God had raised to go to build the house of the Lord, which is in Jerusalem. And all they that were about them strengthened their hands with vessels of silver and gold, with goods and with beasts, and with precious things, besides all that was willingly offered. Also, Cyrus the king brought forth the vessels of the house of the Lord, which Nebuchadnezzar had brought forth out of Jerusalem, and had put these things in the house of gods. They were put in the house of gods, not in the house of God. Even those did Cyrus king of Persia bring forth by the hand of Mildareth the treasurer, and numbered them into Sheshbaz the prince of Judah. And the vessels of gold and of silver were 5,400. All these did Shebazar bring up with them of the captivities were brought up from Babylon unto Jerusalem. Chapter 2, beginning with 64 through verse 70. The whole congregation together was 42,303. Besides their servants and their maids, of whom there were 7,337, and there were among them 200 singing men and singing women. Their horses were 736, their mules 245, their camels 435, their asses 6,720. And some of the chief of the fathers, when they came to the house of the Lord, which is at Jerusalem, offered freely for the house of God to set it up in his place. They gave after their ability unto the treasurer of the work 61,000 drams of gold, 500 pounds of silver, and 100 priest's garments. So the priests and the Levites and some of the people and the singers and the porters and the Nethinims dwelt in their cities, and all Israel in their cities. Background: the children of Israel had experienced a period of sheer rebellion against God. Because God is merciful, he sent his prophets to speak to them concerning their ways. So in the days that we live in, God sends pastors and preachers to give us the word of God and tell us about our ways so often. Now we know that there are prophets today, but they don't often speak the way the prophets in the Bible spoke. It says he sent his prophets to speak to them concerning their ways, but they mocked the messenger of God and despised his words and misused his prophets until the wrath of the Lord rose against the people. Do you often hear people say, well, don't shoot the messenger, I'm just bringing you what the word of God says. As a result, the young, old, male, female, rich, and poor were led into captivity. Many died in Nebuchadnezzar's attack, and those who lived were taken away to Babylon, where they were servants to Nebuchadnezzar and to Belshazzar after him. Ezra 1 begins with God fulfilling his promise to return his people to the land of promise after 70 years of exile. Some call the Israelites the second Exodus. In Jeremiah, this was prophesied. So if we look at Jeremiah, verse 29, chapter 29, verse 5, build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take their wives and beget the sons and the daughters and take wives for their sons and give your daughters to husbands. In verse 10 of Jeremiah 29, it says, for thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you and cause you to return to this place. So often we recite this verse that comes behind verse 10. For I know the thoughts I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me. When you search for me with all your heart, I will be found by you, says the Lord. And I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations, from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord. And I will bring you to the place from which I caused you to be carried away captive. Amen. And verse 25 of Jeremiah, chapter 25, verse 12 reads, then it will come to pass, when 70 years are completed, that I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, the land of the Chaldeans, for their iniquity, says the Lord, and I will make it a perpetual desolation. So he's telling us here about the captivity of 70 years and how he would bring them out. Now Cyrus the king of the extensive Persian realm, the Persian Empire, drafted a proclamation that allowed the Israelites to return to their land and rebuild the temple. Cyrus made the proclamation in his first year of 538 BC. This was the first year of his reign over Babylon, but he had been king over the territories for more than 20 years. The fulfilling of Jeremiah's words, what we just read in Jeremiah 29:10, and Jeremiah 25:11-12 was totally God's doing. 70 years of Jewish captivity in Babylon was about to end. The edict came about because the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus. It says that he moved the heart of Cyrus, that he stirred up his spirit. This shows the sovereign hand of God behind the events of history to stir up, to arouse, to cause him to do something. So this is what he did. He stirred up the heart of Cyrus. Even though Cyrus was not a believer in God, he still stirred up his heart that he could do what he had wanted him to do, to go to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. Has God stirred up our hearts to do anything? Has he called us to do some things? He tested our hearts and asked us to do certain things, and we did it because we felt in our heart that this is what the Lord wanted us to do. Cyrus said that Yahweh, the God of heaven, had appointed him to build the temple at Jerusalem. Part of this decree is recorded in 2 Chronicles 36, verse 23. I will not read all these verses for the, we don't have time, but I will give you the scripture and you can go back and read it. God had promised the Jewish remnant that he would raise up Cyrus as his servant to restore the fortunes of his people. Under the Holy Spirit's guidance, the prophet Isaiah referred to Cyrus by name about 150 years before the king made his decree. Elsewhere in the Old Testament, the phrase occurs only four times. It points to God's sovereignty. He is the one who made heaven, who is in heaven, and who reigns from his throne in heaven. Isaiah 66:1. Though Cyrus was a monarch over the extensive empire, Yahweh is far greater, for he rules from heaven. The temple was of utmost importance in the life of the people of Israel. Without the temple, there could be no sacrificial system. What was the nation's lifeblood in the relationship to God? The God of heaven, as we see in verse 2, is also the God of Israel, who Cyrus said was in Jerusalem. Cyrus' edict in verse 4 also instructed the returnees, neighbors in Persia, to give them the equivalent of money, silver and gold, material goods, livestock, and free will offerings. What is a free will offering? A free will offering is something that you give freely. You don't have to be prodded. You don't have to beg anybody to do anything, but it is a free will offering. The reminiscent of the Exodus from Egypt, when God miraculously took the nation out of bondage and had the Egyptians aid them with silver, gold, and different gifts. Now God was effecting a new Exodus, again bringing his people who had been in bondage back into the land of promise, the land that he had promised them many years ago. Now God is a God that keeps his promise, right? If he says that he's gonna do something, he's gonna do it. Now God's timing and our timing is not the same. So God did promise that he would bring them back, and we know that it took 70 years. Much as he had made or done under Moses and Joshua, the people had been in bondage to Babylon because of their failure to keep their covenantal obligations, which Moses had given them during the first Exodus. Once more, God was miraculously working in the lives of the nation. The Lord God of Israel caused Cyrus to figuratively wake up to the group of people in his kingdom who had borne the brunt of many prejudices and injustices. The great thing about the word stir is that it implies that God is saying to Cyrus, get up from your complacency. Lift up yourself and do something for me. Cyrus follows through the stern with an obedient spirit and a listening ear to hear, thus saith the Lord. What about us? Do we listen for the word of God that tells us, thus saith the Lord? Do we act on what thus saith the Lord? Or are we just hearers of God's word and not doers of God's word? He says, get up. Go do what I have told you to do. The result of God's stirring is that Cyrus made that proclamation. What about us? Cyrus' proclamation begins by establishing his own power and naming the power that backs him, saying, God gave him all the kingdoms of the earth. But Cyrus makes certain to specify which God he means. His God is in heaven, and he wants a house in Jerusalem, in Judah. The question, who, is not about identity. This is who is meant to draw out the willing. Who is he among you who is willing? Who amongst you are willing? Are you willing to do what God has called you to do? Or we just want to sit back so often and says, not me, let somebody else do it. Do you remember Moses when he told God that, I don't know how to speak, God. I can't do that. My speech is not good. And God told him what he should do and what he should say. So the same goes for us. If God gives us something to do, he would make provisions for us to be able to do. He ain't just gonna throw us out there and have us to do it on our own. The purpose of Cyrus' proclamation was to grant full permission to Jews exiled to return to their own country if they so chose. Now they didn't have to go. They could stay where they were. So there were two kinds of people, the ones who were going and the ones who were going to stay. Remember I said God's people need to remember that the Lord God is sovereign over all nations and can do what he pleases with the most powerful rulers. People don't have to be Christian believers, as I said, for God to use them. Whether they're presidents, mayors, governors, God can use all of them. That's why God has, in his word, has told us that we should pray for government leaders. God can exercise his sovereign power to accomplish his purpose for his people. This is the reason that Paul exhorts believers to pray for those in authority, not that our political agenda might be fulfilled, but that God's will might be accomplished on this earth. 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 8. How much longer? 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 8. Reads as thus, therefore I exhort first of all the supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and perseverance. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who draws all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time, for which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle. I am speaking the truth in Christ and not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith. Desire therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up the holy hands without wrath and doubting. So we have to pray for all men, because God can use whoever he wants to use. The king's decree boldly acknowledged the Lord and called him the Lord of heaven, a title that is used 17 times in Ezra, Nehemiah, and Daniel. The decree addressed two kinds of people: those who wanted to return to their land and those who preferred to remain in Babylon. The latter group was urged to give offerings to help finance the expenses of the journey and the restoration of the temple. The Jews also accepted gifts from their Gentile neighbors. When the Jews left Egypt, they plundered the Egyptians. And that's found in Exodus 12, verses 35 through 36. And they collected the wages the men should have received during their years of slavery. Now the Jews were making their exodus from captivity, so they collected wealth from their pagan neighbors and dedicated it to the Lord. Verses 64 through 70. The return of the remnant. God not only stirred the spirit of Cyprus to grant freedom to the captives, but he also stirred the hearts of the Jews to give them the desire to return to Judah. For it is God who works in you, both in you, and to will and to do for his good pleasure. That's Philippians 2:13. The same God who ordains the end of the rebuilding of the temple also ordains the means to the end. This case, a people willing to go to Judah to work. Has God stirred your heart? What has he stirred your heart to do? Not only did the travelers carry their own belongings, but they carried 5,400 pieces of gold and silver from the temple vessels, which had been taken from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar. And if you get a chance, read 2 Kings 25, 8 through 17, Jeremiah 52, 17 through 23, Daniel 1, verse 2, chapter 5, 1 through 3. These items were carefully inventoried by the treasurer and delivered to Sheshbazzar, the appointed ruler of Judah. The word Judah in Ezra 1:8 refers to the district in the Persian Empire, not to the tribe of Judah. In verses 64 through 70, and I'm not going to go back and read them again, Ezra wrote nothing about the long trip, which was 900 miles, or what the Jews experienced during these four difficult months. It reminds us of Moses' description of Abraham and Sarah's journey to Canaan in Genesis 12 and 5. This undoubtedly is a thank offering to the Lord, giving them a safe journey. The people gave their offerings willingly, my time is up, and according to their ability, which is the way God's people are supposed to give, according to Nehemiah 7, 70 through 72. Both the tribal leaders and Jerubbaal, the governor, gave generously, and the common people followed their good example. I believe that my time is up. My superintendent has just came up here and told me so. But I could go on a little bit longer, but I will be obedient. I hope that you have received something from what I have shared, and remember those scriptures that I gave you. Most holy and gracious God, we thank you, dear Lord, for this opportunity. Pray, oh God, something said has reached and has pricked the hearts of your people, that they will be stirred up to do what God has called them to do. I thank you and I give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.